Hello. Good morning, everyone. Thanks for being present here on a Saturday morning. I know most of them you've been partying on a Friday night. So my name is Aditya, and I am part of Fulfillment and Service Group at Flipkart. I am part of the product team. And today I'll be talking about the location problem, some of the aspects that Divya also mentioned in her talk, that how this problem is very unique to India, and how at FSG, or Fulfillment Service Group at Flipkart, we are solving that problem. Okay, so the agenda for today is I'll be introducing FSG, or Fulfillment Services Group, what at FSG we are doing currently. Then I'll be talking about the location problem of India, and what is the impact of location problem to the supply chain, and what is the havoc that it's causing on the supply chain. Then how FSG is solving that problem, and the way forward. What is our vision to ensure that we deliver the best-in-class customer experience that we promise to the customer. So introducing FSG, what is Fulfillment Services Group and what it is responsible for at Flipkart. So Fulfillment Services Group is responsible for ensuring best-in-class customer experience after the customer has placed an order. By this, what I mean is that once the customer has placed order on a Flipkart website, right, from that point till the order is delivered to the customer and even beyond delivery, the entire experience is controlled by the services offered by FSG. FSG offers different kind of services, and to get into detail of those services, I'll quickly walk you through what is the entire flow of a journey or order journey after an order has been placed. So quickly talking about it, whenever an order is placed, it's created into multiple shipments. Each of this shipment then flows through different facilities or the supply chain network that exists within Flipkart. So a shipment will flow through a fulfillment center. So we have hundreds of fulfillment center, and it will then flow through a sortation center. Where it'll be sorted further to move it to a delivery hub. And from delivery hub, it moves to a customer. Now think about a situation where you have hundreds of fulfillment centers, you have hundreds of sortation centers, thousands of delivery hubs, and millions of packagings moving through this complex network. So there are millions of packages that flow through the complex supply chain network, and you'll be hearing about this more when my colleague Senthil talk about this in his presentation on orchestration and network intelligence. So just giving you a brief to tell you how a shipment flows through the supply chain network within FSG. Now, coming to the address problem in India. Before moving further, I have a question, like how many of you understand your address? It's like all of you, right? I mean, you live there. You have to understand your address, right? Okay. So why I ask this question is that I want to share a few examples of how India understands the addresses. So this is an example of a very good address where the user has been kind enough to provide the details about house number, the apartment name, city, locality, and all the things, right? So user very well understands the address. Another example of a address that user has provided. So as we move forward, right, an example in front of you. So here the user has only provided locality. So user believes that this is what the understanding of my address is, and this is how I have been giving my address, and this is how everyone is able to connect through me to my address. Moving forward, the user says that a locality or a landmark. So this is my address, right? Anyone who has to connect me has to come to near this bus stop and I'll be there. Right. Another example looks like a perfectly good address. If you see, one of the important address attributes here is the PIN code. The PIN code is something that the Indian Postal Service has provided us. That's how the entire geography of India has been divided, right? But I don't think that all the users have understanding of the pin code also, right? So in this case, in this example, the address is of some other pin code. It actually belongs to 560017, but the user has mentioned pin code 560103. And this is because of numerous reasons, like one of them being that this is how traditionally they have been writing address and this is how they write it. And this one is my favorite, right? So this is example of an address where user has provided, I think, a lot of information here, right? And user has shown great intent to actually find himself also, right? So the user has mentioned that you can ask anyone. So just translating whatever, you can ask anyone and they will take you. So I think thanks to the user for giving a good intent of the location, what exactly they want to do, right? And helping RFEs to reach to the location. Right. So this is how a snapshot of how India understands the addresses, right? So each and every user, each and every customer, everyone has its own understanding of the address, right? And there is no right or wrong, right? And why there is no right or wrong? Because address itself is a combination of numerous attributes. And all those attributes are not standardized, right? There are a bunch of attributes such as state, city, or even pin code, which can be standardized across. But then that does not solve the problem, right? So consolidating all this, what are the problems that are associated with addresses in India, right? First of all, the scale itself is a big problem. There are zillions of addresses, multiple combinations of how user understand, multiple attributes. As I mentioned, none of the attributes are standardized, right? For example, city like Bangalore have crosses, right? City like Delhi has sectors. Even within a city, Delhi has sectors, Delhi has nagars, they have gullies, right? So you don't get the luxury of standardizing the attributes. Another problem is that the addresses are organized very poorly physically, right? So logically, it looks like sector 23 has to be next to sector 24, right? Or house number 43 has to be next to house number 42. But that's not the case always. So the logic division does not work always within the Indian context. And as I have shown you numerous examples, users don't know or understand their addresses, right? And all these problems are further accentuated in tier 2, tier 3, and tier 3 plus communities, which are the next growth engine for the economy as well as the e-commerce industry. So what does this all mean for the supply chain, right? I think Divya also mentioned in her talk, right? It results in a lot of inefficient manual planning. And why manual planning? Because you have to rely on the local knowledge of your hub managers or your field executives to actually do the entire route planning, to actually do the entire shipment flow planning. Another problem that it creates is unoptimized shipment flow. So in my first slide, when I talked about the flow of how order moves through the various facilities within the supply chain network, if let's say customer has given one wrong pin code, right, then it can enter into a different facility from which it is supposed to be delivered, which would mean that either an order is delayed or the customer is contacting multiple times the customer support to know where my order is. Right. And the third most important thing is customer discovery in the last mile. I'm sure most of you would be an online shopper and may have faced this situation that delivery boys are calling you that, okay, I'm here, how to come to your location? Or are you available, right? So the discovery of the customer, and mind you, the customer has given the right address. So customer has said that this is how I know my address and this is how I've been giving my address. So now it's your responsibility to come to me, deliver it without disturbing me, right? So what does this all mean, right? All this pans down to one point, which is degraded customer experience. So a delivery boy calling multiple times to the customer, right, is very irritating for the customer. Shipment not getting delivered on time, whatever time has been promised, is again degraded customer experience. So keeping all this view or all the problems in mind, how at FSG we are solving this problem? So before jumping into the solution, what we feel is that every address has to be standardized in some form. One way of doing that is obviously you get into different standardized attributes. You create labels of address, right? But ultimately, the micro point for doing, or the micro unit level for doing any planning, is the geocodes. So what I'll talk to you about is and how we are solving the problem of geo prediction, right? Different companies are doing it in different way. So today I'll talk about how FSG is solving that problem. At FSG we have been doing is we have built a Flipkart location intelligence platform, which we called as Flip. Flip is a crowdsourced platform with the aim of geo predicting each and every lat long. And we use machine learning algorithms and some of the techniques that we use, I'll be talking about the flow of how do we geocode an address. Within Flip, when I say crowdsource platform, right, we are not using or not relying on data source from one particular source. We are using multiple data sources, one of the most important being one of our own database. I think there was a question from one of the gentlemen in the audience that over the time you get your own database, then why are you not leveraging it? So this is what we do exactly. We are leveraging our own database because we do millions of deliveries and we have got millions of exact location points. That has its own set of challenges, which I'll talk later, but that's one of the very important database that we have built. The another database that we use is MapMyIndia data. So we also rely on their network, how they have created the idea of localities, sub-localities, and all that is called as the location type. So give you a brief about how do we geocode using a geolocation service that we have built. So if you see an address mentioned here, 691 Shahid Bhagat Singh Apartment, Pocket 3, Dwarka. This address is fed into the geolocation service as an input. So address attribute is a standard input, and we tokenize an address. So again, Divya talked about some of the tokenizing techniques. We follow some of those techniques and have also built on top of it. So a token, what would a token look like? If you see at the bottom of your screen, Dwarka is one token. Sector 14, Shahid Bhagat Singh Apartment, Pocket 3. These are examples of a typical token that will come out of an address. And these are very few examples. There are numerous tokens that are created within an address. For each and every token, we retrieve a polygon. Right? What do I mean by this? So for Dwarka as a token, we'll obtain a polygon. Now, how do we get a polygon? For Dwarka as an address, we have done a lot of deliveries on the locations where Dwarka is one of the address. So we'll have many geo-coordinates available for that. So we'll take each and every geo-coordinate and generate a polygon out of it. Once the polygon is generated, right, each and every polygon, for each and every polygon, for each and every token, area intersection score is calculated. So what do I mean by area intersection score is? So for example, in this case, let's say sector 14 is a polygon. So sector 14 intersecting with Dwarka, we calculate what is the intersecting area of a sector 14 polygon with a Dwarka polygon and divide this by the total area of sector 14 polygon and come up with a score of a particular polygon. This process is repeated for each and every token, and the area which has the highest score is returned, or the polygon which has the highest score is returned. So the idea of taking the intersection is that we get as close or as or pinpoint the exact location of the address, because that forms the basis of the precision or accuracy of your geo prediction. Right? Now, how do we get to the geo prediction accuracy? Once a polygon is returned, or once the final polygon is selected with the highest score, we create a bounding box across that polygon and we take the diagonal of that polygon as the precision accuracy in meters. So what are the critical outputs of a geolocation service that we have built? So latitude, longitude, and precision. So precision is very important to know exactly that, okay, what is the level that you are operating or you are geo-predicting. And that's a very critical output because different precision levels are required for different use cases and applications. So this service has a lot of use cases and application. Some of them are like navigation. Another one is like identifying what is the exact customer location for a field agent. Another one is automated beat planning or route planning that we do. And I'll be talking more in detail about the automated beat planner that we have at the FSG. So before going into details of what is automated beat planner, what it all is doing, how it's consuming the geolocation service, I'll quickly introduce the concept of beat. So beat is nothing but a sequence or order or route that a field executive or a delivery executive follows on the ground when he's handed the shipment. So every day delivery executives are handed, let's say 40 to 50 shipments, and they deliver those shipments in certain order and following a certain route. So that is typically called as beat in supply chain language. Moving forward to automated beat planner. So with automated beat planner, we take number of inputs, we process these inputs, and the idea is to generate a automated beat plan which maximizes which minimizes the overall cost of the delivery, but ensures that the guardrails of customer experiences are maintained. So let me detail out some of the inputs that go into automated beat planner. One of the inputs is order size, right? What do I mean by order size? So number of shipments that are there in an order, typical characteristics of a shipment, which is like what is the size of the shipment, what is the type of the shipment, whether it's a hazardous material or not. So all those inputs which are associated with every shipment, what is the category of shipment, goes as one of the inputs. Then geocodes, which is coming out of Flip service, geolocation service. Slot time or delivery time. What are the delivery times or slot times that customer has chosen or what we have promised to the customer for the delivery. Capacity. So we have different type of vehicles that are available in our supply chain to attempt deliveries, be it vans, be it bikes. So each vehicle has certain capacity, or there are different ways of defining capacity. Some we define what is the maximum carrying capacity or what is the range of capacity that you want to operate into. And the other important one is the traffic. So what are the traffic conditions that exist in on a particular day at a particular time of the day? So all these inputs, and there are other inputs as well, right? These are major inputs that we are currently consuming in automated beat planner. All these inputs are fed and ABB processes, and once ABB processes, the output is a beat plan. So the beat plan is generated to, again, minimize the cost. And when I say minimize the cost, it's function of numerous factors here. The productivity, the number of shipments that a field executive can deliver, the capacity or the how much utilization you have done of a vehicle. So all those factors contribute to the overall cost equation. And we ensure that the guardrails of the customer experience are maintained. You don't want that you have made a promise to your set of customers that we'll deliver by this time, but to minimize on the cost, you miss that promise. So the idea here is that we continue to deliver best-in-class customer experience, but by deploying technology, we keep on reducing the cost of operations. So that's the overall journey of an automated beat planner, that how it does. Now, let me talk more about what happens when a beat plan is generated. Like, if you see on your screen, this is a UI that is shown to our planners. Right, it tells completely what is the area, what is the different routes that different delivery executives have to follow, what is the order. So each and every geolocation here is an address or a customer location where delivery is supposed to be done. There are certain features that we give to our planners. Right, one of them being manual override. So what I mean by manual override is that whenever a planner feels that one of the orders is not planned in an efficient manner, right, there is a chance to, or there is an opportunity to move it from one beat to another, right? Now why would that happen, right? If the system is predicting it, why would a planner want to do this, right? Or why we are given this functionality, right? So what happens is that many times at ground, right, the reality on that particular day may not be exactly what has been planned. Right? For example, you have planned for 10 beats, assuming that 10 field executives would come every day, right? But there has been an attrition, or not all of them have reported. Or let's say all of them have reported, but because of some unforeseen circumstances, one of the field executive had to cut short his delivery of today, right? So that's one of the reasons why we have given this. Plus, every model or every system will have certain accuracy, right? And this is a continuous evolving process. We take feedback of every delivery that we do, and we feedback into the model. So we keep on improving the accuracy, but whenever there is an error rate, we throw it out of a delivery area, and then we have to rely on the ground knowledge. The idea is that we want to do away with it, but if we don't give that address, we have to deliver it, right? So all the exceptions are handled in different manners, right? So some of those we even call the customers to try to get a better feedback of their addresses, right? But those cases are very small, and the idea is that we reduce or minimize those cases or those use cases with time. So the services that powers the key features of automated beat planner are geolocation, which I've already talked about, the geodistance service. So geodistance service basically gives you the distance between various latlongs. So you basically feed the latlongs, and it will give you a road network distance between different latlongs. And we use to create a distance matrix to come up with what is the route plan that has to be created. Maps interface. So the entire map interface that you are seeing on the screen, this is a Flipkart map interface. So this is created on the data. So we create our own tiles on the base data that we have in our database, as well as we use the MapMyIndia data to create tiles. And this map interface is powered by Flipkart itself. And traffic prediction. So these are the services that are currently used by automated beat planner to do the entire beat planning or the run sheet planning. So what is the way forward, right? Looks like, okay, we have are solving the problem of address. We are doing the manual. We are moving away from manual planning. We are doing the automated planning. But is that good enough for customers? Right? Is this pushing the boundaries of customer experience? Right? So we at FSG believe that there is a lot of room to push the boundaries of customer experience itself. Right? So what we want to get to is a perfect matching of supply and demand. Now, before going forward, let me talk to you what I mean by perfect match. Right? A perfect match means that each and every shipment or each and every order should be assigned to a particular delivery channel in a perfect manner. Right? When I say a particular delivery channel, what it means is that a particular field executive, a Kirana store, or a third-party logistics partner. Right? And who will define this? Right. So there are two key stakeholders that are involved in this entire operation. One of them is, of course, our customers, and the other one is our field executives or our delivery executives. Right. So customers will themselves keep on pushing the experience boundaries. Right. They will define that, okay, for me, perfect experience is that you are able to deliver it to me whenever I want, wherever I want. And that is my choice, right? You are able to deliver me without contacting me even for once, right? And for our delivery executive partners, right? They would want that, okay, I want to do deliveries from this time to this time only. I want to do deliveries in this particular area only, right? So the matching or the perfect match of supply and demand is dependent from the supply partners, which is our field executives, as well as our customers. And this is our vision. This is the way forward that we want to go to. So this brings to the concept of the allocation engine, right? Again, the idea of an allocation engine is to ensure perfect match of supply and demand, match each and every shipment, each and every order with the most convenient or the perfect delivery channel. And there will be a lot of input services to it. I've already talked about Flip and ABP, the location platform and the beat planner. The other key critical service that we are building and that will form the genesis of allocation engine, right? The most important one being customer availability service, right? So what do I mean by customer availability, right? Can I predict during the day or during the week the point when the customer will be available to make a delivery attempt? Now, what do I mean by that? Many of us place orders on our office address, right? Because Monday to Friday, mostly in our peak times, we are in our office, right? So, imagine a situation where I, as a customer, have placed an order, right? I have given my office address and I've been given delivery date, or I've chosen by mistake delivery date as Sunday, right? Now, we know that a customer will not be available there on that particular day, right? So if we can predict for each and every address or each and every customer input when the customer will be available, right? This will become one of the important components which will again push the boundaries of customer experience. The another service that is very critical to push the boundaries of customer experience is FE scoring engine. So FE is basically the field executive or the delivery executive. What do we mean by FE scoring engine, right? Now, different FEs or different delivery executives will give different performances, right? None of the two people are similar, right? So we want to ensure that the feedback or the performance of each and every FE is given as an input to the allocation engine, so as to ensure that the customer experience is not degraded. Example is that, let's say, one of the FEs says that the customer is not available at the location, but actually the customer was available. He made what we call a fake attempt, right? So we want to get that and power that into the allocation engine. Another thing on the supply side for the perfect match is FE skill and preference. So as I mentioned that every FE would have a preference of delivering certain time in delivering certain area. So we capture that. And FE skill, so what do I mean by this is that certain categories may require certain skill to do a delivery. A category such as TVs or washing machine, which would at the time of delivery require some kind of demo, versus a category such as mobile accessories, will require different skill levels of the FE. So we take this input and push this. And other one being service and capacity engine. So for each and every delivery channel, we have different capacity and different serviceability. So what we want to ensure is that every shipment is given to a certain delivery channel, which ensures a perfect matching of supply and demand. So this is the vision that we want to move towards and are working towards this. So that's pretty much. Thank you. Happy to take any questions that audience might have.
Hi, Aditya. My name is Senthil Kumar.
Hi.
I'm here.
Sorry.
Okay. See, what kind of accuracy were you guys able to attach in terms of identifying the exact location in terms of distance? For example, 10 meters, 20 meters, or anything of that kind.
Okay. So before answering you that question, right, I'll give you one example of a live experience that I experienced on the field. Right. And what I did was I went with one of my field executives, right, on the field. We have pointed him to an accuracy up to 20 meters, right? And believe me, even after making few calls and he going into one direction, I going into another direction, we were not able to find the customer location, right? And why this was, right? Because customer had never mentioned his house number outside his outer. And the gullies that we went into, right? I have never been to those gullies, right? So why I'm sharing this example is because this has different accuracy levels are required for different applications, right? If let's say I am doing a shipment planning, right, that which delivery hub it should land into, right, then maybe I don't want to get into an accuracy level of 100 meters, right? I want to get into an accuracy level of 1 kilometer is good enough for me, right? But if I am doing a planning for the last mile delivery, right, then we want to get it as close to as 200 meters, right? Now, how we have arrived at this number of 200 meters is we have a internal metric of, let's say, how much reattempts are happening. So we see that what is the sweet point at which the reattempts start flattening out, right? So we figured out that sweet point currently is 200 meters, right? Having said that, that is not the, I'll say, the best number. Reason being that it will change across the geographies, right? We move into a tier three cities, that number can change again, right? So this number, I'm talking more about the metro cities as of now. So this is what we achieve towards or plan to do towards.